Mr. President, this is not a night for jokes or badinage. The debate is too serious for that. But I will attempt to deal with the sincere but limited arguments put forward by my opponents tonight. The question is, should we legalise assisted dying in this country? It's a question we have avoided for a long time, and it's easy to see why. Assisted dying is a deeply sensitive area of law that evokes deep emotions, emotions which, however well-intentioned, can cloud judgment. But if we are to have a proper debate about this hugely important issue that will affect all of us one day, we have to strip away the drama and consider this. Should UK law allow terminally ill patients to choose how they die? As it stands, Barbara Grainger didn't have a choice. The 75-year-old who was suffering from motor neurone disease knew her illness would gradually render her unable to talk, eat, or move. She starved herself to death, and it took 24 days. There are many interpretations of assisted dying. My right honourable friend asked for clarity, and you will hear quite a few of these definitions tonight as people tried to fudge the issue. But I want to make absolutely clear that what this motion is talking about applies only to the terminally ill and to mentally competent adults. It allows the dying patient, after meeting strict legal safeguards, to self-administer, we're not talking euthanasia here, to self-administer life-ending medication prescribed by a doctor. This is similar to assisted suicide, which in the UK is also currently illegal, but with the important addition of the transparent involvement of healthcare professionals. We are lucky to live at a time when we enjoy huge medical advances which can alleviate pain and prolong the life expectancy of healthy people. However, some still suffer terribly against their will at the end of life. And the question for society is, how should we deal with that suffering? In Parliament, we've begun to address these questions. In March, as my honourable friend says, I tabled a motion which saw MPs unanimously endorse the Director of Public Prosecution's guidelines on the crime of assisted suicide. These amount to very limited exemptions from prosecution for those who compassionately help a loved one to die. For example, driving someone to the Dignitas clinic in Switzerland. Tonight, the question you have to ask, is that what you want? Is it right that we outsource this process to a clinic in Switzerland or to friends and family? I think not, and I ask you to agree with me. The cornerstone of a civilized society is that people have a say in the way they live and, yes, in the way they die. Yet here in the UK, the terminally ill can't choose to have an assisted death and to die with dignity. And we're failing them in their hour of need. We have heard of palliative care, and I have spoken of terminally ill people taking matters into their own hands. But many choose to end their days receiving palliative care. It's their choice. And I fully support the role of palliative care, which does so much for those at the end of their life. It enables the terminally ill to die getting the care and attention that they need and want. It's their choice. But the availability of palliative care should not be justification for denying choice to the terminally ill who wish to end their own life at a time of their choosing.
Point of order, do you accept that actually palliative care delivery is a core skill of all generalists, and we also have specialist palliative care, but every doctor and every nurse should be able to provide baseline palliative care and call on somebody with specialist skills if they're out of their depth?
Of course I agree with that. Who wouldn't agree with that? Would anyone disagree with that? Palliative care is essential, but it has to be a choice. It's not the alternative. You can choose palliative care, or you can choose to make the decisions that affect your end of life. And the law must be equipped to respect that choice. Assisted dying is not about wanting to die or forcing death. It's about wanting to live with the comfort of knowing that there is a choice. The cruel irony of faith-based resistance to assisted dying is that it is achieving precisely the opposite of what it sets out to do. It fails to protect the vulnerable. It denies them choice. It also fails to protect those who can't afford the considerable cost of visiting a clinic abroad. Dignitas is only a way for the wealthy. Scaremongering and hysterical euphemisms, some call it killing on demand, have for too long clouded this debate. They argue that pressure is put on the elderly to cut their lives short to avoid being a burden on their families. And there is no evidence to support this. Let me give you the other side of what's happening in Oregon, the US state. Assisted dying was legalized there 15 years ago. The system works safely and effectively. Numbers are low. Assisted deaths have never amounted to more than 1 in 400 of all deaths per year. And there's no evidence that potentially vulnerable groups, such as those with disabilities or the elderly, are negatively affected. Oregon's not alone. Belgium, Luxembourg, the Netherlands, Switzerland, and the state of Washington all enable some form of assistance to die. All democracies, all still standing, none have been visited by the dire predictions of doom by opponents of change. Democracy, ladies and gentlemen, is built on the premise of giving competent adults access to the relevant information and then trusting them to make decisions for themselves. And that is the key to it. But we can't ignore the concerns of the British Medical Association, which remains opposed to assisted dying. We heard my honourable friend recite the Hippocratic Oath. It says a doctor's job is to save lives. Despite this, surveys reveal about 40% of doctors do support a change in the law. And in around 2,500 cases per year, doctors, sometimes illegally, hasten a patient's death for humanitarian motives, either at the patient's request or, more worryingly, without their consent. And this alone illustrates the fudge in our current laws. And this is the answer to the proposal of the motion tonight. A legal right to assisted dying would allow a patient to freely discuss their wishes with healthcare professionals. This is where the safeguards are. This allows diagnosis, prognosis, assessment of mental capacity, and whether there has been undue influence. The truth is, without assisted dying, we deprive ourselves of the proper safeguards against it. A decision to hasten death draws on the depths of human experience and is intensely personal. But it is our responsibility to see that people have the choice to die in a manner of their choosing, with dignity and without unnecessary suffering. Geraldine McClellan was dying of cancer and chose to go to Dignitas to end her suffering. She wanted to end, as she put it, the deplorable dyingness of her life. And if you take one thing away from today's debate, let it be Geraldine's words. When dying cannot be avoided, let us be compassionate enough and tolerant enough to respect choice. I urge you to support the motion.
Thank you.